No score in Chicago. We move to the bottom of the second inning for the White Sox. Ex-Yankee Lyle Mouton, designated hitter tonight for Terry Bevington's team. Not a lot of action yet this year, just 1-for-7. Of course, the White Sox acquired him in the Jack McDowell trade when Jack McDowell was traded to the Yankees 2 years ago. And the pitch again, down and away, ball one. Mouton, like teammate Albert Bell, products of Louisiana State University, one of the best baseball programs in the country. Of course, Lyle is also a basketball player there.
Yeah, he's no small guy. He's 6'4", about 240 pounds. He's in that Frank Thomas territory.
And Rogers struggling again.
Go ahead, Jimmy.
When I see that center field shot, it's like you'd like to reach down and pick him up and just move him about 6 inches to the right. Because the motion all goes to first base, and so does the ball. That's on the edge. Of course, he works off the third base side of the rubber. So he's over there to begin with. That's squirted foul, and it's 3-2. But he works off the third base side of the rubber and then steps. See right here, he's way over on the third base side, and he's going to step over in that area, and you have to come way across your body. You don't get as much on the ball, and it's much more difficult to be consistent with your control. In on the hands, looped down the right field line, a long run for Witten, and he doesn't. It's a fair ball. He had it, and you can identify with that as an outfielder, having that ball bobble up and down while you're running.
Well, you have to make a long run such as Witten did here, but he should have had this. It was a basket catch, but the eyes begin to bobble up and down, and momentarily when you lose sight of it, see, he's got his eye on it, but the eyeballs are moving up and down a little bit and caused him to miss it. And the catcher, Joe Girardi, coming in behind Mouton, trying to pick him off at first base.
And the third error of the year for Mark Witten as Lyle Mouton reaches to start the White Sox second. Here's Chris Snopek. That ball's hit well to left center field. Bernie Williams is on the run near the track, and he's going to make the catch. Snopek has shown a little pop in these two games. A couple of hits in last night's game, including a double.
And thank heavens for cold weather and a big ballpark. Snopek hit that ball right on the nose. White Sox complaining about, some of the White Sox complaining about this ballpark. The ball doesn't travel well here. And I think Snopek thought that this ball should have been out. And Bernie catches up with it right on the front part of the warning track. They scored less runs, about 100 less runs at Comiskey than they did on the road. They scored more runs on the road.
Here's Paco Martin. That's interesting because as Martin takes strike one, when this park first opened, one of the comments made versus the one across the street, particularly where Snopek just hit that ball, is that the ball carried. I don't have the exact data in front of me as far as home runs, but I thought this was more of a hitter's ballpark than the old one. Mouton, not a base stealing threat, is back in time.
And another thing that's helping tonight, helping the pitcher, that is the fact that the wind is blowing in a bit. And it's cold, and obviously the wind, the ball doesn't travel as well in cold weather as it does in warm weather.
Yeah, usually April and September are the pitcher's months, but when it heats up, all these ballparks now, particularly the new ones, are pretty conducive to hitting it out, like Camden Yards.
Back.
I walked down to the field before today's ball game, and you know, last night the balls were just shooting through the infield here, and they've got that grass cut, I mean, just like a nut, and it's as fast as lightning. They have a lot of hitters that like to hit the ball on the ground, you know, chop the ball down on the ground. They don't have to worry about the Thomases and the Bells because they're going to hit it out of the ballpark, but most of their players like to chop the ball. They're taking advantage of that fast infield.
See, Martin has a guard, face guard, similar to Charlie Hayes. He was hit in the face with a foul ball. Chases that one. Actually, I think it was a thrown ball that hit to Norberto. He said some tough injury problems during his career. Missed 1 year with an ankle injury.
He almost comes out of his shoes to try to hit this one. He needs about another 3-inch extension to his bat to be able to hit that one.
Got hit on his throwing arm a couple of years ago on the elbow. That took a little strength out of his throwing arm. Chases that one and fouls it out of play.
If he continues to chase that pitch, David Wells is he's decided to. You left-handers, I'll tell you what, you never know what's going to happen.
Boy.
But it's a cold night, and David wants to keep his head a little bit warm.
Yeah, he's getting ready for his start tomorrow.
Unless he's taking something where his hair has grown a little bit more.
Keep you loose on that bench.
Boy, I'll tell you. We had a guy, Jimmy Pearsall, who played for the White Sox. Used to be a White Sox broadcaster.
Ball gets away from Girardi, and Mouton now the throws into center field. But Bernie alertly backing it up. Curveball in the dirt, and a very alert play by Mouton. As soon as the ball hopped away from Girardi.
Big breaking ball. Girardi does all he can do with it, and that's knock it down. But a smart play by Mouton. Heads up play, that is. Another heads up play by Bernie Williams backing it up. Otherwise, Mouton would have been in third. The point I was making about David Wells with that hair the way he's got it is that Jimmy Pearsall came to Yankee Stadium one time back in the days of the Beatles when they were just coming on the scene, and he was the first guy to put on a Beatles wig. And he came to the plate with it on to hit.
Well, if he didn't have the designated hitter, Boomer would probably do the same thing, David Wells. Trying to think who he resembles with that mop on. It does keep you warm in the dugout on a night like tonight.
Keeps him warm, and he keeps everybody else loose.
Yeah, you know, Eddie Caginelli, our astute and alert associate in the truck, hit it right on the button. Looks a little bit like the Eck. He just needs some of the edges trimmed off the hair. Dennis Eckersley's got to, and he's going to come up with a split finger.
And he needs about $25,000 worth of plastic surgery, too, the rest of it. Don't tell him I said that, will you? I like the Boomer.
And again, Martin stays alive. Both starting pitchers, we talk about, they set the tempo and the pace for how crisp a ball game is going to be played. And both Alvarez and Rogers tonight are sort of working in slow motion, which doesn't make it easy for the guys in the outfield. They're all on their elbows, on their knees. And that one's hit out toward Mark Whitten. The strong arm will force Doug Rader to hold Mouton at third base. Rader, the third base coach, and the White Sox now runners at the corners with just one out.
Well, he had been pitching him away, away, away. Then he comes in, and it ends up over the middle of the plate, and Martin just fights it off in the right field for a base hit. But the point that you make on that pitch, the pitch was up. It was not down. If the pitch is down, he probably either hits it off the end of the bat or hits a ground ball the right side.
Yeah, everything is flat right now, and you know from being a hitter, if you could face a right-handed pitcher like that, how much easier it would be to see the ball. Here's Ron Karkovic. That's low for a ball. And right now is the time when you can challenge this White Sox lineup. You know, one of the things a pitcher ought to do before a game is pick up the stat sheet, look at the hitters, who's been drawing walks, Tony Phillips about your only guy, and who's hitting. Well, they got three or four guys hitting less than 200. And those are the guys you just say, hey, if they're not hitting, I'm going right after them right now. Now, maybe when you come back in July, they're hitting 275, 300. You take a different approach. But right now, it's the old kick them while they're down theory.
Absolutely. You got to play those streaks, and that's what everybody does. Karkovic, 263 career hitter against Kenny Rogers. But Karko can hit the ball on the ground. That's what Rogers wants him to do right now. He wants to try to get that double play if he can. But he's got to make the quality pitch to do it.
Martin back in time.
Another look at this throw to first base. Check that, the pitching motion. That's where you want to work for the ground ball, but you got to get it up in the strike zone a little bit more.
Again, Rogers with an unusually high number of throws to first base.
He doesn't seem to be comfortable.
See, watch the arm angle right now come from somewhere about out in here, and it should be up a little higher. See, it's over there almost where the Sox sign is in the background there. Watch where that arm angle comes through. It's almost going to go right through where the Sox is, and it should go about where the AM radio sign is. Should be up a little bit more.
That's all in the wrist.
Yeah. Never really finishing off the motion. Karkovich chases the curveball, and it's 1-2. And you know from playing the outfield, Bobby, you can begin to see Mark Whitten and Bernie Williams and Mariano Duncan, boy, they're down on their knees, they're crossing their arms. It's cold out there. And that's why a lot of times there are better plays made behind pitchers that work quickly. Keeps everybody on their toes. Again.
Well, it gives you more time to think about what you did in your last at bat. Yeah. You can see Mariano, he hasn't had to hang around left field too much. It's pretty lonely out there, is it, Mariano? You don't have a whole lot of support like you do on the infield, somebody to talk to.
That's low, and it's 2-2. I love to watch your ex-teammate and our good friend Lou Piniella at times like this. You could look out there, and Piniella would be right in his hitting stance, right? He'd be down there.
Yeah, you worry about what
stroke.
You did your last time at bat. You worry about where you're going after the game. You got a lot of time to think about things besides the baseball game.
Got him. Runners on the run, and Girardi's throw is in time. Mouton held his ground at third, and just like that, Rogers, who had been struggling, makes one good pitch, strong throw by Girardi, and the White Sox are cut down in the bottom of the second. We go to the third, no score.
The Knicks gear up for another NBA championship run with first round action beginning next week, right here on MSG. May springs your way with a great lineup of big-time sports action on MSG Network. There's New York Rangers hockey. Catch all the action as the Blue Shirts battle through the playoffs with an eye on Lord Stanley's Cup. And New York Knicks basketball heats up as Patrick and company continue their own playoff run. Tune in before most Knicks and Ranger games for interviews, lineups, and features on MSG's comprehensive pregame show. Al Trotwick hosts MCS Cannon Game Night. Yankees baseball is in full swing on MSG. Don't miss the world champion Bombers as they battle the Rangers, the Orioles, and the rival Boston Red Sox. Get the lowdown on all the upcoming events at the Garden and the Theater with MSG's own magazine show. Mike Crispino and Kathleen Murphy host At the Garden. Take a hard look at today's fast-moving sports world and the people who make the headlines. Bob Page hosts Page One. Plus, you can always catch the latest scores, stories, highlights, and all the Tri-State Scholastic sports news on Coors Light MSG Sports Desk. It's another great month of May sports action on the New York sports leader, MSG Network.
We're all over it.
1996 was a very good year, full of cheering crowds and champions, magic moments and dreams. It was a set of days when any day could turn out to be the best day of our lives. When a guy once lost would find his way home. When a team with heart would take us all the way. And a guy from Brooklyn would become a king. Yeah, it was a very good year. And now the fun begins again. So come on, 97.
No score at Comiskey. We go to the top of the third inning. White Sox threatened in the bottom of the second, runners at the corners, but a strikeout throwout ended that threat. Luis Soho, number 9 hitter, fastball a little bit high, ball 1.
Well, we've talked about the computer. Joe Torre going with Soho tonight. Kelly not swinging the bat that well, but Kelly's stats against Wilson Alvarez about the same as Soho's, except he has 6 more strikeouts against Soho, so that one. So
Kelly, about frustrating for, we've talked about pitchers and not challenging hitters and falling behind. Here's a perfect example. Luis Soho looking for his first hit of the year, hitting in the number 9 spot, 0-91 against Alvarez, and yet the count has already gone full. Guy you'd think you could get out of there in 2 or 3 pitches, or try to anyway. Chases a bad one and stays alive.
call challenging the hitter. You see it so much in the American League. You hear so much about what has happened to pitching now in the last 10 years, how watered down it is. I've heard that phrase many, many times. And the quality of pitching that you're getting.
See,
and the new method, the five, and then your
five
bullpen,
and fly.
Five and fly, the bullpen, the middle, and then the setup man, and then the closer.
See, I think the potential for good pitching is still there. I think the approach has changed. It's just hard for me to believe, as Derek Jeter chats with a couple of his young fans here. Of course, he probably has some family coming down from Kalamazoo, Michigan to watch him too. That's not too far away. Soho rips it right at Sopek, knocks it down, has time to make the throw to Thomas, and there's one down in the Yankee third. Let's take a look, Bobby, and compare the pitching motions of Kenny Rogers and Wilson Alvarez. The windup is just something to kind of get your body going and get into some rhythm. And if you stop it right there, see, this is where everything starts for a pitcher. It's how quickly you get the ball out of the glove. Let's see what Kenny Rogers does. His hands are in very tight to his body. Alvarez, on the other hand, a little farther away. His arm will get out of the glove a little bit quicker than Rogers. See, Kenny's arm drops down and then up. Alvarez, on the other hand, comes right. And I think a lot of that breaking ball swung on by Jeter. So again, watch the arm come up quicker. And the motion of Wilson Alvarez much more fluid. And I think the reason for that is he's pitched his entire life. Kenny Rogers was an outfielder in his high school days. Jeter pokes it foul, and it's 0-2.
You remember the other night when Kenny was, when he ran into problems, his problem was we did a, Bill got a nice shot of him standing up. He wasn't following through with his motion, and the time that he had the problem, the one inning, he wasn't following through. He was standing straight up as he delivered the ball towards home plate.
Yeah, he doesn't have enough flex really in his legs. Missing. We're talking about a guy. I mean, it's not like the guy's a bad pitcher, because we're talking about somebody who was the number one pitcher for the Texas Rangers and has been a top left-hander in the American League the last few years. But
we're talking about mechanics,
right,
and the reason for certain pitches not to have the type of life to it that they normally should have. And you know, I put a lot of emphasis on the catcher. The catcher should know his pitcher inside and out, and when he sees that, and he should be aware. And it should be a reminder of the catcher when he sees that ball flat up in the strike zone to get out there and say, look, you need to get on top. You're standing straight up. I mean, there's always a reason for it, and I think the catcher plays an important part in that.
1-2 to Jeter. Ooh, good swing there. Derek fouled it straight back. Just missed it. Point you make, Bobby, is our colleague and close friend of mine, Tim McCarver, who you hear a lot in New York on the Mets games. We were teammates in Philadelphia. Timmy would run to the mound saying, I don't know anything about pitching, but I know that the where you're releasing the ball is not where you were doing it last inning. So you got to make a change there somewhere. And that's what you're talking about. Alert the pitcher as to what a catcher might see that he's doing wrong. Curveball low.
That catcher is the quarterback, and he's the one that controls the game. And he's the one that knows his pitchers. He knows what pitches they throw, what is effective and not effective. And it should be up to him to constantly remind. How about Carlton Fisk? How many trips he made to the mound?
Wore out the grass.
He wore out the darn grass because he was talking to his pitcher so much.
Good at bat now by Jeter. He's fouled off some tough pitches, and the count has gone full. Another look at the Kenny Rogers motion. This is what Bobby's talking about. Just watch the lower half, the legs. And he's going to finish pretty well straight up and down. Not a lot of flex.
Pretty straight.
Mm-hmm. Derek Jeter draws a walk. Even though he's only 1-for-12 on this road trip and has had trouble making contact, he put a good at bat on Alvarez there and worked out a walk. Quickly looks for the steal sign. And good hit and run situation for the Yankees. That's why Girardi is hitting second. I say look for the steal sign, Bobby, because last year at this time we talked about Joe Torre's National League Baseball and how many times they bunted, how many times they hit and run and stole bases. That bats outside for a ball. This year, they've only had one sacrifice bunt, and they have the second fewest. There it is right there. Stolen bases, five, and they've been caught the most time. So the running game is not in motion yet this year for Joe Torre.
1-0 count. Better be careful.
And you saw in that shot, Don Zimmer seated right next to Joe, and most Yankee fans that followed this ball club all last year knows that Zim whispers those little suggestions into Joe's ear. Hey, now would be a good time to run. Now would be a good time to hit and run.
Just constant reminders.
Well, Will Alvarez putting his infielders to sleep. Yeah, Snowpack walking around to try to stay warm. There's the signal from Martin to Durham as to who's going to cover second base. And you notice Derek Jeter does not have a big lead. And you know, if the hit and run is on, it's not necessary to get a big lead. You're not trying to steal the base. You just want to make sure he goes home, and then you're off with the pitch. Popped up. Right center field, Phillips is there. He puts it away, second out of the inning.
Girardi looking for something to hit to the opposite field. It just happened to be up in the strike zone. But his intention when he went to the plate this time was to hit the ball behind the runner. He just didn't get the pitch to do it on.
And that'll bring up Bernie Williams. The average just under 300. Side, ball one.
Well, the keystone combination is Martin on the left side, and you got Durham on the right side. Number 23 on the hat of Durham is the number of Robin Ventura, who was injured severely before the season started, and he's out for the rest of the year. Hopefully that injury will be rehab.
Let's watch how the infielders communicate with one another without saying anything. Ah, now every team you played on, let's see if it was the same. Anytime it was open mouth, it was ooh, you cover. At least all teams I played on. And if it was closed mouth, it was me, I'm covered. So if that's the sign they're still using, Martin with the open mouth means on a running play, Durham would cover.
And when they stick their tongue out, that means
they don't like each other.
They don't like each other at all. Yeah, they like each other.
High, and it's 2-1. A painfully slow pace for Wilson Alvarez. As you see Bernie's career mark against Alvarez. Good fastball, 2-2. Mentioned the stuff is there. When you're 0-3, you're trying to get that first win. Sometimes you tend to pitch a little tentatively, as Alvarez is doing tonight. Cecil waits on deck. Now here's a young man the Rangers traded away, the Texas Ranger, who's 19 years old, and in his first start with the White Sox back in 1991, he pitched a no-hitter against the Orioles. So you know he's got the stuff.
Yeah, and he's won 15 games twice in his career. Talk about that trade. That's the Sammy Sosa, Scott Fletcher trade for Harold Baines and Fred Manrique back in 1989.
Alvarez finally challenged Bernie Williams with a couple of good fastballs. Williams down on strikes. We go to the bottom of the third inning. Still no score at Comiskey.
Everybody, Cousin Sal from America is coming from the airport. Not exactly, but Sal got some deal.
Did he get computerized driving directions like Hertz?
Not exactly, but he'll be here.
Excuse me!
Sal speaks Italian.
Excuse me! Excuse
not
me!
Not exactly.
In Europe, there's Hertz and there's not exactly. Make sure you choose the right one.
It's me, Sal from America! Anybody up?
Not exactly!
Yes, dime.
Plymouth Voyager is a Consumer's Digest Best Buy. So we're celebrating by giving you air conditioning, 7-passenger seating, and a very nice door prize. So for no extra charge, you'll get the 4th door on any Plymouth minivan. That's up to $18.45 in package values and savings. Even with all of that, Plymouth Voyager is still this low price. So hurry in and claim your Plymouth Voyager door prize.
Now for deep cleaning, the Hoover Steam Vac. Not a vacuum, it washes out dirt, yet it's easy to use as your upright.
Hoover, nobody does it like you.
Darren Lewis leads it off for the White Sox in the bottom of the third, takes strike one from Kenny Rogers. One of the better center fielders in the major leagues, Darren Lewis. But with Dave Martinez, the left-hand hitter, a little better at the plate, he has not seen a lot of playing time. It's outside, 1-1.
Got a lot of speed.
Change up. Knocked down by Rogers. Quickly to his feet. And low throw to Martinez gets away. And Lewis is going to reach second base. Second error of the night by the Yankees. Rogers, a good fielder. Quick reactions.
Yeah, he played it perfectly. Even when he comes off his glove, he didn't panic. He took his time, made sure that he picked the ball up, and then he throws it low, and Martinez couldn't hold on to it. I don't know if he slipped or what, but
yeah, he never got the back foot planted. And you could see what Tino didn't stretch for that ball. He played it, you know, with both of his if he stretched for it, he might have had a little better chance of picking it up. But Darren Lewis is on second base now with nobody out. And Tony Phillips will step in. A little animated discussion with home plate umpire Tim Cheetah. Inside, ball one. Gives you 9 hard innings of baseball and enjoys playing the game. Tony Phillips, always into it.
Very valuable player on a ball club, as you watch Lewis lead off at second. But they can play many positions for you, and he plays them well.
2-0.
So if you have a problem or an injury at a certain position, Tony can go and play it for you. He'd give you an adequate job there.
Yeah, and you see how he gets on base. That graphic, 9 out of his last 11 times. And he's hit well against Kenny Rogers.
He knows the strike zone about as good as anybody I've seen. Always gets a lot of walks every year.
Butts right out in front of the plate, and Joe Girardi will have but one play as Darren Lewis got a good jump from second base, so the sacrifice is successful. And the White Sox have Lewis at third with just one out.
Tony had something else on mind besides sacrificing. He wanted a base hit out of that. He just got it deadened just a little bit too much. You can see Rogers hitting the ground just in case Girardi wants to go to third to try to get Lewis. kind of a chance there. And I think Tony's a little bit mad at himself because he had what he thought Charlie Hayes back at third base, and he could have bunted for a base hit. He just deadened it a little bit too much.
Kind of a win-win situation.
Yeah.
He didn't get the base hit. He still got credited with the sacrifice. And here's Ray Durham. As the Yankees pull the infield in here with just one out. Low for a ball.
Well, you pull the infield in, obviously you want to try to cut the runoff, but Kenny Rogers throws a lot of ground balls, and you got Ray Durham who can hit the ball on the ground. He's got pretty good speed, but you're going to go with the percentages here and try to cut that runoff if you can.
Yeah, if Frank Thomas were at the plate, infield probably be playing back, but he's just been in this situation twice this year. Way off the plate, 2-1. Trying to keep that left arm loose. Of course, Kenny underwent arthroscopic surgery in his shoulder and his elbow in the offseason to do a little repair work, but completely healthy when he came to spring training. And this is the danger right now, being a nibbling type pitcher. You fall behind 3-1, and you got Frank Thomas in the on deck circle.
I don't know if it's nibbling or he just can't throw a strike.
Way outside. And Durham draws a one out walk.
Not even close to throwing a strike on this pitch. Mechanic wise, standing almost straight up as he delivers the ball towards home. You can see how up he is. And consequently, that ball was flat in the strike zone, and it was up and out of the strike zone.
Now you mentioned, is it nibbling or can he just not throw a strike? Thomas steps in. That's way outside. I think for me, control for a pitcher is mostly mental. If you think about throwing the ball in the strike zone, most of the time you're going to do that. But when you're thinking about nibbling, you're missing it about 70-80% of the time. 2-0.
Well, he's really building himself a hole here with runners at first and third and the big hurt at the plate, only one down. But the hitter knows that the pitcher is struggling, and he's just looking for him to throw something into his liking.
That one was, and it's hit well, but right at Bernie Williams. So a little bit of good in that for each team. The Yankees get a big out on the line drive by Thomas, but the White Sox get a run. Thomas's seventh RBI of the year on the sacrifice fly.
Thomas hits this one hard, and that's where Frank Thomas likes the ball. He likes it up just a little bit more. That ball did have some sinking action, but Thomas hits it to Bernie Williams. Bernie had him played perfectly too, because that ball was hit on the line.
And Albert Bell steps in. Awkward move to first. Looked like almost for a
slow
moment.
Slow motion.
Yeah, he froze. He was going to balk. I mentioned a while ago, pitching down and away is really a pitcher's strength, but there are exceptions, and Frank Thomas is one of them. See where that pitch was below the knees outside corner, but he went out and got it. Durham back in time, and if Durham is paying attention to the score in the game, he's not going to want to get too big a lead with two out and Albert Bell in the batter's box. This is the guy the White Sox want to swing the bat and produce some runs. Two steps and a dive, right? They always taught us when you lead off first base, you get two big steps so that if the throw's over there, you can take those two back, dive into first, and they'll never pick you off.
And if you're getting back easy with the move, then you can take another half a step or maybe even one more step.
Slide step. And I think what we saw in that swing, Bobby, is sometimes constant throws to first base throw the hitter's timing off.
But this time here, Albert wildly swinging at that one. That was looked like a ball hanging up in the strike zone. You can see that Albert Bell, that's what they've been talking about, that front shoulder flying out, and you saw his head, it just flew off the left hand side, and he had no idea where the ball was.
Inside corner. Wow, and that, you see him grimace. That's a pitch early in the count that Albert Bell usually swings at.
Look how he is extremely mad at himself too for letting a pitch like that go by. Obviously Albert was looking for something else in a different location.
Hit well left field right at Mariano Duncan, knocks it down, can't make the play, and Durham's going to be waved home. So the Yankee outfielders having a little problems hanging on to the ball, and that ball was scalded right at Mariano Duncan. He gave up his body to get in front of it.
There's nothing like having to make a try to make a play with a line drive off the bat of Albert Bell. No doubt that this ball is knuckling. He got a good jump on the ball.
Now this is how fast it gets out there, normal speed. It's got there in a hurry.
Breaking ball, and it's live. Watch Mariano right there, and it's off the heel of his glove. He's unable to pick it up, and that ball was scalded.
See how they score that. That's the third error of the night for the Yankees. That pitch outside to Lyle Mouton. That has scored an error all the way on Duncan. That's outside, 2-0. In fairness to Mariano Duncan, when you haven't played the outfield, you played there 4 times in 2 years, and somebody hits one of those sinking line drives at you like that, it is not an easy ball to handle. Not easy if you played out there every day.
They always find you, no matter where you're at.
Ball will find you. So the White Sox now lead it 2-0. As ex-Yankee Lyle Mouton has run the count to 3-0. And first strike. Another rather lethargic outing for Kenny Rogers, and yet the Yankees dish down a pair, and one of those runs unearned. 3-2. Got him. Came back from 3-0. Strikes out Mouton to end the third. Al Troutwig, Susan Waldman will be around, be along in the top of the fourth. We go to the top of the fourth inning with the White Sox now on top by 2.
Line shot grabbed by Martinez.
You're watching MSG Network. We're all over it.
Another NBA championship run with first round action beginning next week right here on MSG.
Celebration continues when the world champion New York Yankees take on the Chicago White Sox on April 25th at 7:30, the 26th and 27th both at 1:30. The 26th and 27th is calendar weekend. All fans in attendance receive a Yankees calendar, compliments of White Rose food. Then the Seattle Mariners come to town for 3 big games on April 28th, 29th, and 30th, all at 7:30. Tickets are on sale now at the stadium Monday through Saturday 9 to 5 and Sunday 10 to 5. And at Ticketmaster, the Yankees clubhouse stores, and on the web at www.yankees.com.
tonight. It's only breezy in the Windy City. Chicago White Sox getting a 2-0 lead. Hi, everybody. Al Trautwig with Susan Waldman. And Susan, it seems as though in his times as a Yankee, Kenny Rogers always has one inning of regret.
And we saw it in the last one, his own error, and then of course the error by Mariano Duncan. But you look at Rogers, and we were talking back in the back of the booth, why isn't he throwing that inside fastball more? Because they're swinging at it, and that's what he got the batters out when he pitched against Anaheim. You want to strangle him sometimes.
Well, let's see how Wilson Alvarez deals with a 2-0 lead in search of his first win of the 1997 season. Mariano Duncan coming back to the dugout after mishandling that scorcher off the bat of Albert Bell. And on the misplay, there's obviously something to talk about with Jose Cardenal.
Mariano only played 3 games last year in left field and hasn't played it since spring training. Boy, but it finds you, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. I mean, you don't know what that ball was doing. It could have been dying. It could have been looking like it was rising. Looks like maybe it went off his wrist. It could have been knuckling with it, how hard it was hit. But they're talking about some sort of fielding technique, where to have the glove, where you want it to be to catch a ball like that. But you don't get many balls at you that are a line drive waist high when you're playing in the outfield. It takes someone like an Albert Bell or a Cecil Fielder to do that sort of a thing. The 2-1 pitch to Fielder is fouled back 2-2. Susan, you think Cecil's going to hit a home run this season or what?
At some point. You know, a couple of days ago, Cecil was in the clubhouse looking at tape, and it was the first time I've ever seen him do that. And he really is so aware of how he is lunging at the ball and not staying back, and that is absolutely death for a power hitter. His timing is just way off. Alvarez isn't helping him. You know, I've noticed something different in Alvarez this year so far in these first few innings. He is getting that curveball over for strike, so you can't sit on the fastball anymore.
There's strike 3, and Cecil Fielder is struck out. The second strikeout by Wilson Alvarez. The bad news for the Yankees is it's the last 2 hitters he's faced, so he could be settling in.
See.
Quick check of the box score. You see the Yankees so far in this game all with the big zero.
So that strikeout of Cecil is what I was trying to set up. He sets him up with the curveball now, throws it for a strike, and then comes back in with that fastball.
That'll bring up Tino Martinez, who got a long fly ball that turned into an out his last time up. This is coming to us.
Oh, bad hands. It went out. Oh. You blew it. It's on the screen. Oh. There it goes.
I'm getting booed.
And rightly so.
I am
so
crushed. That was my big chance.
Oh. You had it. It was right there. Back on the field. All right, I'll take it next time.
Oh, man. I didn't even touch it. You better take over.
I'm going under the table if it comes back again.
I'm done. You take over. Oh, boy. 0-2 to Tino Martinez. I'm such a little kid sometimes. On the corner, that's 3 straight Yankees struck out by Wilson Alvarez.
Not even bothering with the curve on Tino, just going right for the fastball. And if he's going to hit that outside corner, he's going to be very, very tough.
What a pitch by Wilson Alvarez. Cut right across the corner.
Outside part of the plate, great fastball.
So now, Mark Whitten will try to solve him. He's the only Yankee to reach base in the last, that's not correct. Whitten walked back in the second inning, hitting 353. Boy, Susan, he goes through so much in getting his bats ready. I was watching him tonight in front of the heater in the dugout. There's tape around the lower handle. Then he puts rosin on the length of the bat. Then he waxes it. Then he puts rosin again. I mean, this is like a 10-minute deal. You know how hockey players do their sticks?
Sticks.
I mean, this is a really elaborate thing that Mark Whitten goes through with his bats. In the infield, what a breeze of an inning this is going to turn out to be for Wilson Alvarez. The Yankees still haven't gotten a hit off of him, and he looks even tougher than he did at the start of this game. 2-0 Chicago. Back.
Nobody does it like you. The way that you do, nobody's got the power to please me.
The Hoover Steam Vac Deluxe deep cleans high traffic areas better than ever. With exclusive 5-brush agitation, it washes, extracts, deep cleans, and it leaves carpets twice as dry as our leading power brush competitor.
Hoover, nobody does it like you. I miss the earth so much. I miss my wife. On such a timeless flight. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time. Till touchdown brings me round and get to find.
Imagine a place that surrounds you with elegance and pampers you with luxury.
Williams, the car, please.
Introducing the Infiniti QX4. It has all the comfort and style you'd expect in an Infiniti.
Williams, while we're young.
It's just a bit more assertive. The new QX4.
For less than the cost of this newspaper, Lawn Doctor can help keep your yard green and healthy. Get the great lawn you want at a price you'll love, $29.95 or less per service. Call Lawn Doctor. Nobody does it better.
Back on MSG, the Yankees trailing the Chicago White Sox by the score of 2-0. Chris Snopek, the third baseman, in the absence of Robin Ventura, and that's going to be a long absence, hitting .241. Ground ball to his own position. Charlie Hayes had a little trouble and the throw will be late. Well, the Yankees are having a tough night in the field. They've already committed 3 errors. We'll wait to see how this one is scored, and the White Sox get a leadoff man on.
The outside of the plate, and he actually pulled the ball and Hayes just can't find the handle on it. It's very cold. Ball's probably very, very slick. Looks like he gets it in his glove, Allen, then drops it, and then when he tries to change hands, can't pick it up with his bare hand.
Boy, last night all the misplays belonged to Chicago and the Yankees ran away with it. Tonight, 4 errors already. E5, E7, E1,
E9.
E9. Reaching for the ball gets away. Did he touch it with the bat? Well, the runner advances on the play. Snopek going to second.
Is the ball's going to bounce right in the dirt in front of Girardi, right on the plate? No, he did not touch it.
So the Yankees, who have not won 2 consecutive games all season, first time they've gone this deep into the season without having a 2-game winning streak since 1966, are having their problems.
Martin, one of these kids that loves to swing, comes out of the dugout swinging. He can play short, he can play a little third, he can play second, he can play the outfield. Great kind of guy to have on the team. Doesn't walk a lot, and you can get him to chase bad pitches.
Martin was the second half of a strike him out, throw him out that ended the second inning. Lays down the bunt, but it's fouled off his body. And he's out. He was out of the batter's box, says the home plate umpire, and Alberto Martin is called out. Tim Sheeta now will get a visit from Terry Bevington. And this is one that'll be interesting to see the replay on. The ball evidently hit Martin while he was out of the batter's box, and you can't do that.
Bevington doesn't look like he's too troubled by this. Here's the pitch.
Right there. Absolutely.
Out of the,
absolutely.
That's right.
Out of the
Here's
batter's
that
box.
Right foot out of the box. See, he's in front of the box right there when the ball hits the bat.
Susan, that's the old T.C. Chen U.S. Open double hit. It's illegal.
What is that?
In golf, you can't do that.
Can't do golf turns to me.
All right, one out now. How do you score that? I'm asking for your help.
I'm not sure. Catcher, 2 unassisted. How's that?
Yeah, but then after the game, you'd never remember what
Well,
what
sure
that was.
You will. You'll remember that play.
Put it down. Ron Karkovice struck out the first time up. He's hitting only 167, line drive right at Luis Soho. They go to second. Late on the throw. Jeter wasn't really there, and I think Snopek was back on the bag anyway. Boy, every play's an adventure tonight, isn't it? There's all sorts of stuff going on.
The inner half of the plate, and Karkovice really is a little late on that, and gets right out to Soho. Soho really loses his balance there. Jeter tries to get over, and Snopek gets back.
Luis getting the start tonight at second base. Derek Jeter up the middle is his partner, of course, and the hitter is Darren Lewis. Lewis was the featured guy in all the newspapers yesterday here in Chicago, and he was quoted as saying, because with the acquisition of Albert Bell, he's not going to get a lot of playing time. He said, look, I understand that, but I'm going to sacrifice this in order to get a ring. And I thought to myself, what team are you planning on getting that ring with?
Darren Lewis was supposed to really take over from Lance Johnson. They let him go thinking that Darren Lewis was going to be able to take over in center field, and just hasn't been able to do that.
Hitting only 111 as you saw, and Kenny Rogers behind in the count 2-0. Got the corner.
See, this is the Rogers that you saw in Texas a couple of years ago, going aggressively on the inner half of the plate, throwing the fastball and then setting up the breaking pitches with that fastball.
Two balls and two strikes. It's so frustrating. I mean, I remember last season Mel Stottlemyre telling Kenny Rogers, you got to trust your stuff. And as you watch him pitch, it's the three words that constantly to me come to mind. Trust your stuff.
Well, the interesting thing is, since he grew up in the bullpen, he should know how to spot that fastball because he did it so successfully for Texas.
Foul ball.
Last year, you know that he was having a lot of problems with the elbow, a lot of problems with the shoulder, so you can understand it a little bit. But this year, he's got the velocity that he wants, and he's able to spot that fastball and use those breaking pitches. But sometimes he'll say himself, he picks at corners. He tries to make the perfect pitch. He tries to get too fine.
The Sox have only two hits, but the errors have killed the Yankees, that's for sure. So it's two balls, two strikes, two out. Deuces wild here in the bottom of the fourth inning on a cold, cold night in Chicago. Tried to play with the corner, and now he's got to deal with the full count. He's given off the body language like he thought it was a strike.
He thought it was on the outer half of the plate.
Nope, that's where David Weather's ball four was in Milwaukee, off the plate.
Jimmy Key gets that call.
Yes.
Kenny Rogers doesn't.
Fly ball right side. Martinez with some space. Beautifully done over the shoulders by Tino Martinez. And Lewis is retired, and so are the Sox. Fifth inning coming up for the Yankees. They need a couple of runs.
Okay, tune into Bob's Stores for men's, women's, and kids' Levi's jeans. 501, 505, 550, 512, 555, 521. Bob's Stores has your number. Stonewashed, pre-washed, bleached. Bob's Stores has your color. Regular fit, relaxed fit, loose fit. Bob's Stores has your style, too. So stay tuned to Bob's, the only place for Levi's jeans.
Plymouth Voyager is a Consumer's Digest Best Buy. So we're celebrating by giving you air conditioning, 7-passenger seating, and a very nice door prize. So for no extra charge, you'll get the fourth door on any Plymouth minivan. That's up to $18.45 in package values and savings. Even with all of that, Plymouth Voyager is still this low price. So hurry in and claim your Plymouth Voyager door prize.
Sometimes you get a craving for great classic rock. Only Classic Q 104.3 plays continuous classics.
Yeah! And nobody beats the Wiz. We know you know you want a TV, but lines of resolution, features, what size, how much, you know? Well, and nobody beats the Wiz, we do know. We know Sony, RCA, Mitsubishi, Panasonic, every major TV brand. I know big screens, small screens, picture in picture. I know every square inch of TV technology.
All with our great 33-day low price guarantee.
And nobody beats the Wiz. We know TVs. Because what's life without TV, you know?
Nobody beats the Wiz. We know.